Okay, so thanks very much. I'd like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to speak here. So what I'd like to talk about is a little bit more of a down-to-earth about some kind of geometry on a certain site. I hope you'll see maybe later in the talk, there's some kind of algebraic structures which arise, which are maybe a little bit different. And the idea is to view geometry as algebra in some way. So there's a lot of algebraic manipulations that we would like to do, which are sort of inspired by the small object argument in some way, although that doesn't necessarily play a big role in itself. Okay, this is a part of an ongoing joint project. With Ludmila Katzarkov, Alex Noll, and Panav Pandit. And the project concerns basically some stuff about Konsevich Soimelman point of view. Point of view on structure and infinity. Of cluster varieties. Log Calabi-Yau things and stuff like that. And also Gyoto and Mornitsky. Spectral networks. So last time I gave a talk actually about the same subject. So maybe you can see on the video probably something about the general framework of the project. So this time I'd like to talk a little bit more about the precise geometry. So the motivation, I'll describe this a little bit later. The motivation is that if we have a... Andy Nightsky, yeah. We have a family of ordinary differential equations, which we'll call nabla t. Connections on a bundle. The bundle can maybe be fixed. On a Riemann surface X. And we let rho t be the de Monterey representations. Then, as t goes to infinity, say from pi 1 of x into SL, SLN C. Okay, as t goes to infinity, then the rho t.
So you get back 2 or just 3?
Well, it's going to be, n is going to be equal to 3 today, okay? Well, maybe I'll start with n equals 2 to say something about n equals 2. As t goes to infinity, rho sort of approaches a limit, which is an action of pi 1 on a building. And here we're using Perot and Perot's theory. And the idea of our project is that we'd like to understand
Sorry.
We'd like to understand the building, starting from limiting data for nabla t. And limiting data, this is a Higgs field. Roughly speaking, the Higgs field is sort of the leading term of nabla t. It's the term in which has coefficient t. And our Higgs field gives a spectral curve. So we have the Higgs field in particular the spectral curve of phi. So what's the spectral curve of phi? To just be extremely brief, it's just it's a ramified cover of x contained in t star x. For our purposes, we can just view this as a multi-valued section of omega 1x, in fact, an n valued. So let's call it lambda 1, lambda n, with the condition summation of lambda I equals 0. That's the condition that the trace of the Higgs field is 0, because we're looking at SLN representations. We assume that the determinant of the connection is trivial. So in terms of this picture of the spectral curve, the lambda I's are just the different values of the ramified curve inside the cotangent bundle of x. So at a general point of x, we just have n different one-forms on x.
How do you know they're different?
N one-forms, which in the we make generosity assumptions so that, for example, we'll be assuming that the curve is irreducible. If they're not different, then it's more complicated. Okay, so. Yeah, they're the eigenvalues of phi, yeah.
So this is a naive question, maybe, but does this Higgs field have a connection with the SIMPSON correspondence?
Well, a little bit, but not completely. I mean, the last time I was here, I made a board with lots of different columns on it, explaining that a little bit. So let me just refer to the video of that conference.
Which conference are you talking about?
Sorry?
Which video of the conference are you mentioning?
The one for Maxim's birthday. Konsevich's birthday conference. Let's see, so to get down to, now that's all the motivation stuff. So to get down to the basics, so basically, So these are holomorphic differentials on our complex Riemann surface, but we just take the real part, okay? So we get, these are real differentials. The fact that they correspond to real parts of holomorphic differential forms just means that they're harmonic, okay? And of course, I'm saying this away from the ramification points. At the ramification points, a lambda I can switch with a lambda j. We'll see the picture of that in a minute. And the sort of initial lemma, or proposition, let's say, which we did in the in our first paper with Katzarkov, Noll, and Pandit, is that the differential, so let B be the building given by Poirot, then we have a limiting map from the universal cover of X into B. Let me say this is an R building, okay? We have a limiting map, harmonic map from the universal cover of X into B, which is equivariant for the action of pi 1. And the main point here is that D of H is equal to this vector of forms. Now what does that mean? The building is locally Rn minus 1, locally pieces in Rn minus 1. The Rn minus 1 is just viewed as the set of vector L points in Rn whose sum equals 0, or equals some constant. So the condition summation of lambda I equals 0 means that the differential a map into Rn minus 1 is given by n vectors whose sum equals 0. Okay. So this is a, you might say, a valid equation. And this is the reason for this is local WKB theory. Now this is actually, we discussed the proof in our paper, but I guess it was, you might say, probably would have been well known. In any case, for n equals 2, this whole theory is well known. So let me discuss that maybe for now. So for n equals 2, then the Higgs field is just, so then the spectrum of the Higgs field since it's lambda 1 and lambda 2 whose sum equals 1, whose sum equals 0, then lambda 2 is just minus lambda 1. So we just have a plus or minus a differential. And that corresponds to if we take the square, then we get a section of the tensor square of the canonical bundle. So that's a quadratic differential. So you've probably heard the whole theory about the relationship between quadratic differentials and maps to trees, basically. That's what's happening here. B is, in this case, is the tree. Maybe I should say dimension of B equals n minus 1. Okay. So the map H, so in this case, the map, the building is a tree, and the map from x tilde to t factors I guess in our paper we call this phi, maybe. Let's call this whole thing around phi. Where T phi is the tree of leaves of the foliation. Defined by the differential form, real part of lambda 1 or real part of minus lambda 1. Remember that at a ramification point, those two guys can switch around. Okay. Let me just draw ramification point. So a simple ramification point of a quadratic differential is a point where there will be no choice of uniform choice of square root of the quadratic differential. So lambda 1 is going to be something like z to the 1 half dz, which is d of z to the 3 halves up to a constant. Okay. Now if you try to draw the level sets, so the leaves are sort of real part of z to the 3 halves equal constant. And if we try to draw this, we get a, we'll do this in the wrong direction, I suppose, but this classical picture. Okay. So the foliation at a singular point like that, the foliation looks something like this, okay? And the space of leaves is a tree which you might draw in the opposite direction, because points here correspond to leaves here. The origin corresponds to these three lines that come together. This guy is this guy, and this guy is this guy. Okay. And the harmonic map is just, locally, it's just the projection from x. This is in x tilde. This is in t phi. So what's being said here, basically, is that the size of, well, I'm not saying the details, but the size of the monodromy transport function for the connection, if the connection has a large term which approaches a quadratic differential, then the size of the transport from one point to another is sort of it's the integral of this quadratic differential from one point to the other. Okay. This, in Thurston's terminology, this is like a measured foliation. There's a measure transverse to the foliation, and the distance in that measure is exactly the growth rate of the monodromy. Sorry, I should say the monodromy, the size of the monodromy is e to the t times that measure. Okay. Now this what we wanted to do in our project is to understand this for n bigger than 2 and see how it relates to Gyodo-Mornitsky's spectral networks. So when we were here last summer of 2014, we basically decided to concentrate our efforts on the case n equals 3. Maybe I'll explain the reason in a moment. Okay, so the goal, of course, is to understand the case of n arbitrary. So far, we've only been looking at the case n equals 3. The point about this case is that in this case, the real dimension of x is 2, which is equal to the real dimension of the building. In the tree case, and that's why you have this quotient by the foliation, in the tree case, the dimension of the building is 1, and the dimension of x is 2. So the map has to contract one-dimensional fibers. That's why we have these leaves. Okay. In the case n bigger than or equal to 4, then generically, at least, the image of the map is going to be some, you know, thin subspace of the building. Okay. So in that case, it's much less clear how to get a hold of the points of the building. But in this case, at least, the dimensions are the same. So we can hope to get a hold of some points of the building, at least, starting from the points of x. Here we basically got a hold of all the points of the building. I mean, it turns out that the map from x tilde to t phi is surjective. So you get all the points of the tree by just leaves of the foliation. So here what's happening, and that's what I'm going to be talking about today, what's happening is that the image of the curve is some subset of the building, but it's not sort of the whole building. And the part of the question is how to recover the rest of the building. So now this is what leads to the notion of free building. So free building is the thing we get before the building. So this is basically the image of x tilde in b phi. So b phi is, we would like to have a similar factorization statement. Let's say b phi is supposed to be a building depending okay, so we're supposed to have the, we'd like to have a similar situation there. Let me just remark, what's the characteristic of this situation with the tree that we'd like to replicate? So the point is that this map x tilde to t depends on some kind of complicated limiting process. I didn't say so, but in Perot's work, you need to choose an ultra filter. You take some kind of complicated limit on an ultra filter. So the building that you get there, a priori, you don't have any geometric control over what it looks like. Whereas in the case of the tree of leaves of the foliation, we have a really easy, or you might somewhat easy, geometric picture of what points of this tree represent. And that picture only depends on the quadratic differential. So we'd like to have a similar situation here. We'd like to be able to construct a building B phi with a map from x tilde to B phi, with the property that really it only depends in some geometric way on the spectral curve, on these differentials.
The quadratic differential you mentioned is just a determinant of phi. Okay.
It's the determinant of phi, yeah. Okay, so let's call this B phi pre. Now, once you look at an example, so we did a basic example in our first paper. Once we look at an example, we see that x tilde is not going to surject onto a building. So that's why you get this idea of a pre-building, which is going to be essentially the image of x tilde, plus maybe a little bit of extra stuff. And so the idea is that, so mainly, mainly, we would like to construct this pre-building. Then maybe the building, to go from the pre-building to the building, there's sort of a small object argument. But for one thing, it doesn't seem completely unique, and maybe it's not completely essential. So maybe the real statement is that we have a factorization like this. So here's our map to the building H. Maybe the real thing we would like to consider is a map from x tilde to the pre-building, factoring into the building. But the pre-building should sort of contain the structure of the building near the points of x, tilde at least. So now the question is, what is a pre-building? So there's lots of definitions of buildings. There's, you know, books and papers and everything discussing what are buildings and so on. But we can see from this example that we really want to understand subsets of buildings rather than just buildings. And the axiomatics for buildings are usually pretty strongly related to the axiom that any two points are contained in a common apartment, which sort of implies that we're already looking at big R2s, in our two-dimensional building, these R2s that are sort of going off to infinity. And some of those are exactly going to be the directions which are not hit by x tilde. So here's where we get to the question of a site. So what is basic question, what is a pre-building? And so we wanted to have an axiomatic notion of this type of object. And furthermore, so it turns out that there's a whole process involved in the construction of this guy, which I'll be discussing. And we'd like to view that process as something algebraic rather than something analytic. Because a lot of the points of view on buildings have a lot of metric stuff in them. It's important, some of the metric stuff is obviously crucial, but maybe the idea is to try to stay in the world of algebra as much as possible. So that's the, how are we doing here? This is not so good. Just erase this guy. Sorry about this. Otherwise, can I? Okay.
No?
Okay. So now let's consider the case. So our building, let's consider the case n equals 3. Our buildings are modeled on the standard apartment. R2, as I said, should be thought of the points x as the points x1, x2, x3, summing to 0.
Is x tilde the universal? What is x tilde?
X tilde is the universal cover of x. So our buildings are modeled on the standard apartment, which is an R2, and the vowel group x is just S3, and the affine the affine vowel group is translations, semi-direct product, I guess it goes like that, S3. Okay. So these give some kind of special affine transformations. Well, let's call this A. This is the apartment, yeah. So now, what does geometry inside the apartment look like? Geometry inside the apartment is controlled by three different directions. Okay, so there's three directions of reflection hyperplanes. Separated by 60 degrees, okay. So these are the hyperplanes of the reflections along which the reflections are, the transpositions in S3 are reflections, okay. So these are the guys xi equals xj. Now let me comment that, in fact, we have a little bit more structure. So the so at any point we have sort of three preferred, actually six rays. So there are six. But they're labeled into, they're divided into two groups. They have a parity label. So if you think about it, the in S3 there's a rotation of order 3, but there's not a rotation of order 6. So there's nothing which is going to turn us by 60 degrees. The rotation in S3 turns by 120 degrees, which means that the it preserves the parity of the vertices. Okay, so the edges coming out from a point have a parity attached to them, which is preserved.
What, a parity or a direction? Confused.
Well, I mean, there's two groups. There's the white dots and the black dots or whatever. An element of S3, yeah. S3 is the group which preserves, say, the origin. An element of S3 preserves the parity of the edges. Okay. There's no element that goes from here to here. There's only one that goes from here. And you can rotate or reflect or whatever.
You have two triangles, but not an hexagon.
Yeah. Okay, so that's just a sort of side comment. Now we have so we have half planes delimited by these reflection hyperplanes. The reflection hyperplanes in the affineWeyl group are sort of any translates of these guys. Okay, so.
But you are not in the arithmetic situation. You take R2 as translation. Don't
we're taking R2, yeah, because this is due to the motivation here. The edge lengths in our building are going to be sort of exponential. I mean, they're going to be the exponents of the size of the monodromy. There's no reason a priori that those should be in some, I mean, they'll be in some subgroup of maybe probably rank n or something like that. But probably not n, probably. It's actually the periods of the spectral curve. Mark sequence A. But so, I mean, there's kind of the real parts of the periods of the spectral curve, which are some subgroup of R, which are the translation lengths.
But it was just a question of terminology. Usually people call affineWeyl group the arithmetic ones.
Okay, the R affineWeyl group or something. So, yeah. Okay, so we have reflection half planes. Okay, so standard half planes. The half lines are delimited by translates of these three lines. Now an enclosure is just any compact intersection of closed half lines. So it's convex. Okay. So we can just draw these. I mean, a standard one might be a triangle or a parallelogram.
They are intersections of standard
ones, yeah. Any kind of hexagon. We also have a point, so let's call the point P. We have segments. That's about it. By these I mean filled in, of course. Okay, so enc is going to be the category of enclosures. Let's call it enclosure E. So Encke is the category of enclosures with maps which are given by the elements of the affine Weyl group.
The inclusion, no, you don't consider inclusions of enclosure.
Inclusion, yeah, an inclusion.
Category of
enclosure.
The maps.
The maps just have to be linear maps, but they have to be linear maps that aren't, that don't. If they're allowed to turn by an element of S3, but not.
But then they map some figure into another figure.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, a map into. It maps E into F. E into E prime, you might say. Yeah, so for example, a triangle maps into a parallelogram.
Truly inside, I mean,
yeah, of course.
Inside, yeah, yeah. Map, one guy should map into the other, okay. And in particular, the point P maps into everybody in lots of different ways. And the segments, I mean, an enclosure has edges, which are maps from the segments into the enclosure, okay. I mean, there's also a map, there's also, part of an edge.
And there are three directions for the
segments. As long as it preserves, yeah. So they preserve the metric, so to speak.
They preserve the metric, yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a Euclidean metric on this guy. That's not actually the metric which is useful for our WKB problem, but still. Now, so the point is that enclosure has a fairly simple structure of sight. This is, you might say, inspired by, once I heard people saying that rigid geometry, in rigid geometry, maybe Tate had a sight where you had rigid open sets, and the point was that you only looked at finite covers by rigid open sets. I don't know, Arthur can maybe confirm or deny that. Anyway, this is maybe inspired by that idea, which is that coverings are finite coverings. Our surjections from finite disjoint unions.
So what you're defining really is like disjoint topology.
No.
Because from a topology you can take any larger family would also be covering.
The generating covering, okay. Generating coverings. Generating family. The topology is generated by coverings which are finite disjoint unions. The point is you're not allowed, so we're not allowed to, because we could try to do, we're not allowed to, we're not allowed to sort of subdivide the triangle into a whole sequence of triangles like that, okay? That would be a surjection. You would have a surjection from a union of infinitely many triangles onto the triangle.
Yeah.
That's not a covering.
But in your examples, it seems that the interior is some pairwise disjoint. Is this can be over?
No. Maps from disjoint unions. So I mean,
you mean it's like a scissor when you cut? Oh.
So for example, the map from. This would be a covering.
They can overlap.
They can overlap if they want. Of course, the point is not to have them overlap. The point is to have them intersect just along the edges. This guy is not actually going to be very helpful as a covering because
you can always refine into a covering where they don't overlap.
You can always refine to a covering where they don't overlap. In fact, you can always refine into a covering which is sort of standard in the sense that it's just cutting by. cutting by a bunch of lines like that, and so on.
Ah, okay, I see.
But finite.
Finite. Everybody's finite, yeah.
Oh, I see.
So now, what are the sheaves for this topology? The point is that this topology is not subcanonical.
Because your maps are not piecewise, they are?
No.
Yeah. So if we have an enclosure, then the pre-sheaf represented by that enclosure is not a sheaf. But if we let E tilde be the associated sheaf, then what is E tilde of F? So it maps F into E tilde. It's piecewise affine maps. We call these maybe folding maps. So we can have a map from an enclosure to a different enclosure, which sort of folds, but only along, we're only allowed to fold along these reflection lines. Okay. So it can fold things up and do things like that.
So when you say piecewise, it is also finite.
Finite piecewise. That's why we wanted to say that the finite, we only have finite coverings generating our topology.
So there is a one-dimensional version of what you're describing now, which is just somehow piecewise linear maps within the interval?
Yeah. That would be the case that you would use to do the tree, do trees.
That's what Katja told us yesterday. At some point.
Okay.
Excuse me, don't you mean maps from F to E, not E tilde here?
Well, I mean, okay. From the space F to the space E. And in fact, that's a good question. Maybe I should say that the sort of the underlying set of points, so F, so.
Oh, my picture is wrong. I'm sorry. I suggested piecewise linear maps within intervals, but I think the slope should always be one or minus one.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a big restriction.
Mm-hmm. I think, I mean, I didn't think about this too much, but I think that there should be like a piecewise linear version, which is probably actually well known or something like that, of this whole discussion. In this discussion, we're just limiting ourselves, because we're interested in buildings for this file group, we're limiting ourselves to maps whose, which if it rotates, it's only, the rotation is only given by an element of S3. Or in the case of one dimension, S2. I mean, for a general Lie group, you'll have the Weyl group of the Lie group acting on the Cartan algebra, and that's going to give you the transformations that you want to look at. The underlying set of points of E, of an enclosure E, is E of P, where P is the point. Okay. And we can think of that, E of P becomes a metric space, and so on. So here I could have marked F. Okay. Now, the thing that we're interested in doing is we're interested in sort of gluing together these pieces to form something like our building or our pre-building. So. And for that, we introduced just a basic definition. Because let me just explain that there's an example which we would like to sort of rule out. So we might say some bad example. So then our the objects we would like to look at will be then viewed as sheaves on the side of enclosures. Now, a bad example, so let me just, so first of all, note, first of all, that if U inside E, E of P, if U inside E of P is an open set, so remember E of P is just the usual space of points. Then it corresponds to a sheaf, let's call it U tilde, is the set of maps, U tilde of F is the set of maps F into E tilde such that F of P maps into U. But this is not generally finitely generated. You might have a triangle, you might sort of just consider some open set. This open set is sort of tessellated by sub-triangles, but they just have to get smaller and smaller as you sort of go towards the boundary.
When you say open set, you mean a sub-sheaf?
No, this EFP is the usual topological space. Just the triangle. Okay. So when we start talking about arbitrary sheaves, then maybe it's not clear what we want to talk about for the topology, but for an enclosure itself, the topology, it's just the usual topology.
Well, usual Euclidean topology you're talking about, right?
Yeah, inside R2.
Yeah, and U is some strange open set you've drawn there, so.
Yeah. E of P is contained in R2. Okay.
You sort of look at this open set as describing some sub-sheaf of the...
Yeah, it's just the sub-sheaf of all the guys which go into that open set. Which, it's a valid sheaf on the side of enclosures. Okay. It's just not going to be a very nice one. But, I mean, it's one which could actually happen inside our building, in our building, because of the fact that we're talking about edge lengths which could be arbitrary, in particular arbitrarily small, something like this could actually happen inside the building. But what we'd like to avoid is the following thing. So, we like to avoid having something like E1 union E2 over an open set U.
When you glue, you mean?
When we glue, yeah. I mean, E1 might be equal to E2, for example. We might glue together two copies of the triangle over the same open set.
Okay, so you don't want all the sheaves, that's what you want, what you're saying?
Yeah. This is not gonna be a very good object.
So could you impose a finiteness condition?
Yeah, so that's what I'm gonna explain. At least hope to impose. Okay, so what do we do to try to avoid this type of thing? Is we say that a sheaf F is finitely generated if there exists a surjection from a finite disjoint union of enclosures. to F. Okay. I guess like, you know, a surjection in the topological sense. I mean, a surjection has to be a surjective map of sheaves.
And you see a sheaf as a corresponding Hilbert space over the plane. No denied sheaf can be represented by a Hilbert space.
Well, except that we have those S3 actions, I'm not completely sure about that.
So it's a little bit like in topos theory, sometimes you have coherent sheaves or things of the sort. Could it be like the sub-plea topos of coherent sheaves or something like that?
Maybe.
Is this fairly presented, in fact?
Well, I'm going to get to that in a minute. As I said, this is not actually a condition which we usually want to impose because our building is not going to be finitely generated. I mean, it's going to have infinitely many. You know, notice, for example, the R2 itself is not an enclosure because I asked the enclosures to be compact. You could maybe discuss whether you want to do that or not. But in particular, to get R2, you'd have to, you know, cover it by infinitely many triangles. But we say F is finitely related. The fiber product. For any two enclosures mapping to F, the fiber product is finitely generated. Yeah. So I wasn't able to prove this actually, but we would like to show that you get a Hausdorff topological space if we have one of these guys.
So this is like the notion of quasi-compact and quasi-separated. So this is, so it looks like, are you working in something which is like a coherent topos in the sense of?
Maybe. That's a good question. Well, anyway, so. So the definition is that a construction is going to be a finitely related sheaf.
In the case of n equal to 1, the sheaves that you get are some kind of good sheaves, or some kind of polygon, in the case of n equal to 1. I mean, not on the plane, but figures like piecewise, some graph?
I think so. But you can have infinitely many. I mean, it's like an R. I mean, the idea, the goal is to get something which essentially recovers the case of R trees and R buildings. So for the case of trees, that the idea would be to recover the theory of R trees. Because you can have, you know, an arbitrary collection of guys meeting. That's the hope in any case. So the idea is that a construction, okay, a definition of construction is a finitely related. Okay. And now we can do things with constructions. We can sort of construct things with constructions. So maybe an accessory definition is that a cofibration an accessory definition is that, and I think we need this, is that a cofibration is a map of, say, constructions is an injection of sheaves such that for any enclosure mapping into F prime, the trace of the enclosure, the intersection with F, is finitely generated. Okay. This is a subsheaf of E. Okay. So again, we'd like to not have an inclusion of an open set or something like that. And then, for example, pushouts along covibrations preserve constructions. And this is the basic operation which we'd like to use. So let's see. Stopping here. So let me just get back to the case of X tilde and the pre-building and so on. So getting back to our situation, our geometric situation, we can write X tilde as a union of small open sets and sort of define we can kind of define an enclosure for EI for each UI. So maybe modify the open set so that they look in terms of the coordinate system given by the differentials so that they look like enclosures. Okay. And then the UI intersect UJ. Give a gluing relation among the EIs. And from there we glued these together. Glue them together to get F0, which is an initial construction. So the first step to define our pre-building is going to be to glue together little pieces corresponding to small open sets of X tilde.
At infinitely many ones now.
Well, infinitely many to cover X, but sort of locally finitely many. Okay. That's maybe, I was thinking about the case of a foliation in trees. It's actually more complicated than the case of N equals 3. Because in the case of N equals 3, since the dimension of X is equal to the dimension of the building, we're not going to end up gluing together infinitely many pieces. If we try to do this for the foliation for a tree, we might already get into trouble because this gluing relation could sort of glue together infinitely many things. If we take a irrational slope foliation on a torus and we try to do something like this, we're going to end up gluing together infinitely many pieces. So in the case of foliation, you need some condition that says that the leaves don't sort of loop back arbitrarily close to themselves. In this two-dimensional case, just looking at things geometrically, you can just sort of glue together the pieces pretty calmly, you might say. Now the only problem which is left, and now which I don't have time to discuss, but now the basic problem is that F0 is not negatively curved. That's where the algebra, that's where the, you might say, some kind of higher algebra comes into play. So let me just explain why F0 would not be negatively curved. So, there's a negative curvature condition. This is seen if we look at points of our construction, then there's a notion of local spherical construction, which is a graph. And inside the graph, if you have a hexagon in the graph, that corresponds to something flat. Right, it's kind of the local. Did I erase this? The graph will have vertices for each edge coming out of the point, and edges for each two cell. When you have a hexagon, that's something flat. If you have, say, an octagon, then that's going to be negatively curved. If we have something of a loop of length 4, so I'm just going to draw this, you might have something like this. When we do this, when we glue things together, and generally this will happen all over the place, when we start gluing things together according to gluing by little open sets of x tilde, you might say pretty much anything can happen. In particular, a picture like this will happen. So two parallelograms glued together along two edges. Okay. At this point, right, there's at this point the graph looks like this. The graph has only 4 edges on it. And that's a positively curved point. You just geometrically can see it's a positively curved point. And so the basic algebraic problem is
you don't go out of full circle around the point. If you open it, you don't follow, you don't cover the whole circle.
Yeah. If you open it, you only get 2/3 of the circle, yeah. So now the problem to define a pre-building. So a pre-building we would like to be negatively curved. That's kind of the essential thing, which is halfway between the notion of a construction and the notion of a building, is to ask for some kind of negative curvature. And so the basic problem, I'll just explain the problem here without explaining the solution. The basic problem here is that when we have a fourfold vertex like that, well, it's clear what we want to do. We want to fold together two of the pieces, so we're going to have to be gluing together some stuff. Okay. The difficulty is that we don't know which way to glue together, right? You have, it's like this toy of children. You can glue together like that, or you can glue together like this. So some additional algebraic data is needed to determine at each of these vertices which direction to choose. Okay. So there's a procedure of gluing, of sort of collapsing together positively curved vertices. So you'd like to, you know, end up collapsing together these two parallelograms. There's a procedure of collapsing together positively curved vertices, but you need additional information. You need some information of marking of the whole picture, telling you which direction you should glue at each point. And that's the information which is going to come from the original Riemann surface and so on. And so that's what we explain in our paper, at least. We don't actually have it's not a theorem. It's a sort of a program of how you should be able to do this. As you sort of follow through this procedure, so we should think of this as a sort of an algebraic procedure of forming a quotient of this construction according to some additional information.
Does it just come from the Higgs field or more than that?
Well, the map comes from the Higgs field, and then we're using the geometry of the map, basically.
So, but the data that you need to do this gluing choice comes exclusively from the Higgs field?
Basically, yeah. Essentially, I mean, if we had a... If the front parallelogram came from a piece of the Riemann surface and the back parallelogram came from a different piece of the Riemann surface, for some WKB reason, we know that we're not supposed to fold the Riemann surface itself. So that tells us that we're supposed to squish it like that. We're not supposed to fold along this line. But the problem is that once you start folding, then you get edges which a priori don't necessarily come from pieces of the Riemann surface. That's actually where the Guyot-Mornitzky spectral networks come into play, but I'll leave it at that. Okay, so.
You said a the beginning of your talk, you said that there was something about the small object argument.
Well, so that's what, this is what I'm trying to say, actually, because you'd like to, the original hope was just some kind of general procedure, like a small object argument, was going to allow us to map x tilde to a negatively curved space. But it turns out that the small object argument needs sort of, you need to sort of control it as you move along in some way. Because you need to control which direction you collapse at each point. So there's some sort of control of the argument that needs to be done as you proceed. The very first idea is you'd like to say, by a small object argument, we sort of take the universal negatively curved building, negatively curved construction, which is a pre-building, with a map from x tilde mapping to it, with that given differential. The point is that universal guy doesn't actually exist a priori. Okay. And in fact, in exactly the cases where there are spectral network, where there's BPS states in the spectral network, you can see that there might actually be two possible choices. The point is that with a genericity condition, we're hoping to prove that that doesn't happen, basically. So it's kind of small object argument, but with piloting along the way. So you need to sort of maintain the data that tells you at each step what you need to do. Sorry.
I wanted to ask, what is the category of points of the topos you have introduced?
That's a good question. What's the category of points of the topos? Yeah. There might only be one, which would be the point P, possibly.
Only one point.
I'm not sure. Maybe like germs of enclosures at the point P. Probably. So there's at the point P, there would be a point which is a germ of an edge and a point which is a germ of a triangle. So maybe there's three points, possibly. But I don't know, I didn't.
So you have the defining, as far as I understand, when you define this Grothendieck topology, it's defined by finite covering families. And the site in question, does it have fiber products or not?
Does the site have fiber products? I think the site has fiber products, yeah. You can intersect enclosures. One should be careful that products rather than fiber products don't have a good property, products of construction.
So anyway, there is this notion of a coherent topology defined by a site is finite covers with the topology generated by finite covering families. So my question during the talk was whether your topology is a case of this kind of site or does it give this kind of topos? So this, there was no answer to...
I don't know. Maybe.
Okay, but is it... So is it quasi-compact?
I don't know. You know, it's a very simple-minded, you might say, example.
So you're defining objects are those enclosures and the maps are given by things in the affine Weyl group sending one to another, yes? And so, okay, so you, maybe it's locally of this. So is it true that the fiber product of two, that the finitely related guys, as I say, are closed under operations like fiber products?
I think so, yeah. I think so, yeah.
In particular, the fiber product of the basic guys are finitely general. Okay.
The fiber products of basic of enclosures are finitely related. That's true.
Okay. So this starts to look like...
I don't see any reason why that would not be the case.
Anyway, okay. So it seems that there is no finite generating family for the world site in terms of enclosures. You could have larger and larger. No. If you have something small, you can cover. You can cover any enclosure by copies of.
Yeah, but I think probably the problem is the smaller and smaller ones. I mean, You need small. You need sort of arbitrarily small enclosures. You don't need arbitrarily large enclosures, but you need arbitrarily small enclosures. And in fact, you need infinitely many because if you fix some countable collection, then you're not going to get all the possible edge lengths that way. Although, I guess you can cover.
You don't need a finite generator. I just need that there is a generating family with fiber, with finite limit. So you said you have fiber product, and the product in the topos of two, so the product of the, in the topos of two enclosures is not finitely.
No, the product of two is not finitely generated, no. The product in the topos, the product of two enclosures is not finitely generated.
So this means it is not Cartesian then. It's not a coherent topos then. Mm. Because in a coherent topos, whatever comes from the site is a coherent object. And then the category of coherent object is closed under finite limits in.
Yeah, so that's probably not true because the point is that we're looking at only at two. I mean, here we're only looking at two-dimensional objects, and if you tried to take the product of two different two-dimensional objects, it would sort of be a four-dimensional object, but it's not. That's not going to exist. I mean, the product of the sheaves obviously exists as a sheaf. It just doesn't have. It's not very good. Doesn't have very good properties.
No, but the product looks more like an intersection.
Well, the fiber product. So the fiber product, a fiber product actually works pretty well. It's, as you say, it looks like an intersection. But a product, but not a fiber product.
Yeah, but that's all what you need, the fiber product. I mean.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, among other things, one should be careful that the point P is not at all the same as the empty product. The empty product star, you know, the constant sheaf with values equal to one point, is not a good object. It's not finitely related, for example.
So it does not have a terminal object. That's the only difference.
Well, there is a terminal object in the topos, but it's not a construction.
Right. Otherwise, it has fiber product.
Yeah.
Okay, so maybe so in SGA4 they also have a locally coherent and an algebraic.
Yeah, it's locally coherent somehow.
Maybe something like that.
Thank you.